Warm welcome. Myself, Chartered Accountant Ankit Singhvi. I trust everyone is doing well in these difficult times and are safe at home. Today's topic is basically to just give you an overview of alternate investment funds. Probably the time frame is approximately 2 to 2.5 hours, which includes some time for Q&A. I would suggest anyone having any questions, please you can put in the group chat. And Zaki and Sanjeevni are there from Simandhar. Yes. They can guide me whenever there is any questions. So guys, like basically, Zaki would be helping me out in running the PPT slides. So I would be, asking Zaki to just control the PPTs. So please bear with that. To start with about alternate investment funds, maybe Zaki, if you can just turn on the PPT. Okay, great. Moving to the basically the discussion topics for today's 2.5 session is basically I will be starting with giving an overview of on the second slide alternate investment funds. Zaki, can you move to second slide, please?
Yeah, sure.
So as you can see, like the discussion topics for today's session is alternate investment funds, just an overview, what is alternate investment funds. Then I'll give you some overview about hedge funds and like some flavor of auditing hedge funds. We'll discuss about fund of funds, which is similar to hedge funds, but there are certain additional things to be known. Then just an overview of private equity funds and what are the valuation methods that we use valuing investments in private equity. And at the end, I would just like to share with everyone like what is recent headlines or what is currently going with the private or alternative investments. So that is the whole brief agenda for today's session. Moving to the next slide. So when we talk about alternate investment funds, so like as name suggests, it's basically having an investment or financial assets that does not fall into any conventional investment categories like stock, bonds, liquid, fixed income securities. So basically, so far, I'm assuming like most of the crowd is either working professionals or students. So we would have surely heard about like investment in stocks, investments in mutual funds, fixed deposits. So these are all investments. But what is alternate investment is basically not investing in them. So it's basically a non-conventional investments. They are non-conventional investments. Who does who are the investors in alternative investment assets? They are basically institutional investors, high net worth individuals, and sovereign funds, pension funds, funds of family offices. So these are basically institutions which are having huge capital and at the same time good amount of risk appetite, because alternate investments, when you invest in alternate investments, you have to be mindful that they are complex in nature, illiquid, less regulated, and the degree of risk is very high. So that's why these investments are meant to be, for sophisticated investors, and it's not for basically retail investors. What are the types of alternate investments? It includes private equity, investment in hedge funds, other managed futures accounts, art and antiques, commodity derivatives contracts, and also real estate. Basically, all these are, illiquid investments. Before we move ahead, let's see what are the pros and cons of investing in alternate investment funds. Pros are is basically you can diversify your portfolio, you can hedge your inflation, and if there is risk, there is also high reward chances. The cons, the valuation part is difficult since they are investing into complex instruments, and it is illiquid by nature. You can't redeem or withdraw your money invested in alternate investment overnightly. So there are certain restrictions, liquidity, depending on which type of instrument you invest. They are highly unregulated and they contain high risk. So basically, this is just an overview of alternate investment funds, just to guide you, just to brief you, when you hear about alternate investment funds, that means they are nothing but investments like private equity, investment in hedge funds, venture capitals or other things. So it's like a non-conventional investments. I think moving to the next topic. Next slide, sorry. So let's discuss about a little bit in detail about hedge fund, which is part of alternate investment funds. So hedge fund is typically not very famous in India so far, but I am sure it is picking up and it will pick up very soon, considering the overall economical upliftment and the numbers of we can say HNIs and institutional investors showing up in India. So it will start for sure, like, and it will pick up the race. But as of now, North America is the major market for hedge funds. So starting with what is an hedge fund. So I'll just brief you what is, like, before I go into what is hedge fund, let's talk about like background of hedge fund. So I think more like the first modern hedge fund, like, was formed like, around 1950s with the normal, strategy to buy stocks and even like, short selling of securities. So this is like way back, like, 60, 70, 80 years back, this was already started in a lot, very low scale back in Western countries. And now basically when we discuss further about the hedge funds, we'll come to know like which is the major, geography wise, the concentration of hedge funds is high. So basically a hedge fund is an investment vehicle and a business structure that pools capital from a number of investors and invest in securities and other instruments. Hedge funds are generally distinct from mutual funds as they use leverage and is not capped by regulators, and distinct from private equity funds as the majority of hedge funds invest in relatively liquid assets. So, guys, like when you see hedge funds perspective, so yes, they are risky. They are comparatively less liquid to, conventional investments like common stock or mutual fund, but still they are liquid when you compare it with private equity or investment in venture capital funds. So far, I'm sure like many of you have not heard about short selling of securities, because in India, you can't carry forward like any security which you have short. During the day, you have to square it off. But in a Western country, short selling is allowed, and hedge funds are known for that. Whatever investments they make on the long side, if not equivalent, but at a very good amount, they also short securities based on their strategies. So that is the, we can say a unique characteristic of an hedge fund when you compare with any other investment vehicle. So, by the word hedge fund, like, so far as per theoretical knowledge, when we hear word hedge, we means like, we are hedging some risk. So friends, like, just wanted to clarify, like when we say hedge funds, it doesn't mean like, they are doing some hedging. It may be part of their strategy, but sometimes they have naked positions, which they don't have any offsetting position to hedge anything. So, they can short security where if you short the risk of, loss is unlimited, as we have the same risk in long also. So it's not necessary. They will be always having an offsetting position, which will hedge their position. So don't go by the word hedge. It is not purely hedged. And so in reality, no hedge fund is fully hedged. I would rather like to close on that part. So going to the next point, like, how do hedge funds make money? So there are two aspects to it. One is from the investor sides and one is from the persons managing the hedge funds. So from the perspective of investor sides is like, the person managing the hedge fund would be basically pooling money from investors and then putting that money into some investments, earning some capital appreciations or investment income through interest income, dividend income, and then again, pushing that money to the investors. So from investor sides, whatever profits are made on the investments made, that is the income for the investors. But what about the persons who are managing the investment or hedge fund? So basically, it's called 220 rule. The manager, also called as general investment manager, they take like, a management fees, which is based on like the total asset under management. And that sums to around that is equal to like 2% per annum of the asset under management. So this fees is basically fixed in nature, and this is like, you know, more or less around 2% in the industry, irrespective whether the hedge fund makes a profit or not, they will be paying that fees to the investment manager. The second leg of 220 rule is 20 is basically the performance fee. So that is purely based on the performance of the funds. If the fund performed positively, there would be a performance fee and the investment manager would be getting that. And as I said, like if the fund makes profit, so it is variable in nature. In case if there is any losses during the year, the investment manager would not be getting any profits out of it. So in this way, there is an incentive for the investment manager to give a good performance so that they can take like around 20% of the performance what they have made for the investors. So this was about like how do hedge funds make money. Now, who can invest in hedge funds? So far, I think everyone is good. No questions, right, Zaki? No, nothing on the chats also.
There is one question actually.
So
Raju Jain is asking, what is private equity?
So for private equity, I think we have another slide for it. We can discuss over there. Apart from this, any other questions?
No.
Okay. So who can invest in hedge funds? Basically, you know, as I mentioned earlier also when we were discussing about alternate investment funds, it's not for it's not for a retail investor. Okay. So there's something called accredited investors, also called as sophisticated investors. So there is a definition who is an accredited investor, like who are the persons who can invest. So I can read out quickly for you guys. Individuals satisfying one of the two financial status. The first one is annual income greater than $200,000. When I say dollars, it's always USD. Or a joint annual income of at least $300,000 with his or her spouse. Or if the investor, the prospective investor is having a net worth exclusive of his primary residency exceeding $1 million. So if one of the condition has been met, I think that person can invest in a hedge fund and fits into the accredited investors. Okay. So I think, so basically I just, tried to cover like who can invest in hedge funds. They are the accredited investors. One of the condition is having net assets more than $1 million or an annual income of greater than $200,000 individually. And if joint annual income like with spouse, then $300,000. I think there was one question which was regarding like what is short sell. I'll just quickly cover on short sell. Short sell is basically, let's understand what is long. Long sell. Long is basically you buy the security, and whenever there is an appreciation, depreciation, you want to sell it, you sell it. So the first leg is buying and then you sell it. And whatever is the difference between selling minus buying price is the profit that you earn. Short sell is basically you sell the security first at a fixed at a price, and later on you have to buy. In India, it is not allowed. You have to square off the position by the end of the day. But in Western countries, you can see this short selling very frequently. So suppose if I, let's take an example like Tata Motors. If I'm pessimistic about the stock, that the stock may go down. What I will do is I will call my broker and ask him to sell like 100 shares at the price of, say, INR 150. And later on, when the stock is like on the downward turn, like 120, I may buy it back. So the profit on this transaction would be 150, the selling price minus the 120 buying price, which is 30 INR. So this is basically a short sell, as simple as I could explain. Is there any other question so far?
There is one question. So there is one guy, he's asking about, can you please tell the difference between hedge funds and mutual funds? Again,
sure. So mutual funds can't do short selling, whereas hedge funds can do a short selling. That is the biggest difference. And apart from that, investors investing in mutual funds are basically having a great liquidity. They can sell it off immediately the units that they hold. And whereas in hedge funds, the redemptions restrictions are there. So mutual funds can't do short selling. The example that I took, like sell first and then buy it, mutual funds don't do it. And they are highly regulated, whereas hedge funds are loosely regulated. Okay, clear? Or you want me to repeat? Square off is basically if you sell something, you have to buy again. Like if you have sell at 200 at the start of the day, at the end, you have to make sure that there is no negative position. So that is called square off. So if you don't do square off, at the end of the day, it will be seen like minus 100. That is not allowed. You have to buy 100 so that it is squared off. Okay. Okay, guys, moving to the next types of hedge fund strategy and what investments does hedge funds make. So with regards to this, hedge funds can be having like multiple strategies, but you have to understand the crux is basically a hedge fund, utilizes complex strategies involving the use of short selling, leveraging, dealing in derivatives and other asset classes. The only purpose is to generate returns for their investors. Hedge funds are not only complex than traditional mutual funds, but also they are illiquid in nature. So what are the different types of strategy, long and short? So if I say a hedge fund is having a long short strategy, that means most of his assets or most of his money that he has pulled from investors, he will be mostly buying securities, selling securities and earning profit from there. The next strategy could be event driven. Like for example, event driven is basically if a investment manager identifies some kind of, benefit due to certain scenario, so they will always look out for that kind of events in the market and take positions accordingly. For example, a company merger that would be happening after 3 months. So they would be, the managers would be only focusing on that stuff, like, where they can make out good money because of arbitrage or anything else. So that is event-driven strategy. Multi-strategy is basically a mix of all strategies. Like the investment manager can do long short, investment manager can do event-driven strategy or other strategies. Credit strategies is basically the investment manager is more into like lending money at some rate of interest or or to real estate investments through fixed income interest or fixed interest. So that is the credit strategies. And there are many more, but I think distress strategy, as the word say, distress. So in case if there is any fund which is having a strategy where they only focus on the distress assets, they would be acquiring those assets and at a lower price, and whenever the market turns up, they would be selling that assets. When I say assets, hedge funds can also deal in buying and selling buildings. They are open with that kind of objective. So in case of like any crisis like 2008, if they are aware like there is some downward in the real estate market, they would go ahead and find some distressed assets, buy it off and sell it at a good price after certain years. So that is basically a distressed strategy. So we just discussed about like what are the types of hedge fund strategies, and let me quickly cover about types of investments that a hedge fund makes. So when we say long or short strategy or event driven or any other strategy, they enter into this strategy by certain products. So I'm sure many of you are aware like what is common stock. Similar to that, there are other products like bonds, debentures, warrants, futures, options, forwards, equity swaps, credit default swaps, repo and reverse repos. So this are the main instruments which you'll see hedge fund dealing into it. You'll not see in the common a non hedge fund type of setup dealing in all this stuff. That's why we say that the risk is very high, because all these products may be having some hedging or may not be having any hedging. Okay, so I think we can take few questions before I move ahead. Zaki, any questions?
Yeah, there's one question. why common investors are not allowed to invest in HFS?
Correct. So as I said, hedge funds are very risky in nature, illiquid in nature. So basically it is not meant for retail investors. So that's the simple reason. That's why they are not allowed to enter it. For them, if like for a small investor wants to invest something, they can always go to a common, buying self common stocks or investing into mutual funds. But hedge funds are basically for sophisticated or accredited investors, because there is a minimum amount of subscription required. Like you, it can range from like $100,000 from $1 million, like minimum subscription. So that's the reason a retail investor or a common investor does not, you know, invest in hedge funds. And as I mentioned, the law has mentioned a definition, or, you know, I've described like who, what is accredited investors. They would require minimum net assets of 1 million and minimum income yearly of $200,000. So, you know, that's where it's also driven by law. Okay. I think any other questions, Zaki, before I move ahead?
Yeah, there is one more question. Please explain event-driven strategy once again.
Okay, so event-driven is basically, there are many corporate actions happening in the stock market. So there would be mergers, there would be some acquisition, the last recent one which we heard about, Facebook and Reliance. So basically that is one kind of, you know, event-driven. Like if there is some kind of information, or not insider information, but some kind of value that they foresee, even if the news is public, so they would, you know, go ahead and acquire more and more. And when actually this event happens, they can leverage out, or they can earn some money out of it. So event-driven is basically a totally market-based strategy. They have to keep their ears and eyes open and rely on the public information available and assess, like, you know, what value will be derived because of certain corporate actions. So, you know, that is event-driven. Okay. I think we can move to the next. I think, Zaki, there is no other questions, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Moving to the next, like geographic concentration, as I mentioned earlier, also during the start of the session, the place of domicile is, you know, basically there are, you know, globally more than 15,000 hedge funds, you know, and roughly the asset under management would be between $3 trillion and $4 trillion. In North America itself, it's home to like 70% of the hedge funds. Like out of 15,000 hedge funds, 70% of the hedge funds are located in the North America region. And out of that 70%, half of them are mainly either in New York City, California, or Texas. So these are the, like, you know, geographic concentrations. Apart from United States, you will see like funds getting registered in other. Hello, am I audible, Zaki?
Yeah, you're audible.
Okay. Apart from, you know, North America, you'll see other places where the funds are registered. It may be like due to some tax benefit or having some non-US investors. So those countries are basically Cayman Islands, British Virgin Islands, Bahamas, Bermuda, and Ireland. So these are the, you know, hot places where the funds get registered. And why do they go there? Is basically to get excess capital from non-US investors. So investors who are, you know, outside US, they can invest in these entities which are, you know, located either in Cayman Islands, British Virgin Islands, Ireland, Bermuda, or Bahamas. All these countries that I mentioned are so-called tax havens. So either they are untaxed or are very lightly taxed, and the offshore investors can get reap benefit because of this taxation benefit. And so basically we just spoke about like geographic concentrations. It's like 70% are in North America. But as I said, like as in India also, things are picking up, and it will pick up at a faster rate as we go ahead. I think we can move to the next slide, Zaki.
Yeah, sure.
So this is just a glimpse of, like, you know, of top 15 hedge funds. This is not the very latest data, but you can see, like, it is as of 2019, end of quarter one. So this, and you can see, like, the amount of assets that they manage, like the first one, Capula Investment London. So their strategies that they manage around $300 billion. So you can assume, like, you know, how big they are. So you'll see most of them, you know, either in UK or in United States of America. Okay, so this is something I'm sure, like, this PPT or presentation would be shared by with you guys after this session. So you can always go there. I've also mentioned the site from where I have taken this, just an information purpose. Zaki, can we move to the next slide?
Yeah, sure.
Thanks. Okay, so very quickly, the hedge fund structure. Let's concentrate on the one which is on the left-hand side, also called as a standalone. Let's go from top to bottom. So as you can see, there are you know, management company, and the hedge fund is in the middle of that diagram. ABC Hedge Fund LP. So there's a management company who is managing this hedge fund LP. And there are investors who are, you know, investing in this hedge fund. There's also a general partner, because this is a general partnership. So there is a GP, and all those investors which are investing are also called as limited partners. Okay. So once the pooling is done by a hedge fund, they further push it down. You can see the last thing as investment. So this is how, you know, a standalone fund structure looks like, you know, investors putting money into hedge fund doing some investments, and management company and general partner running the fund. Okay, that was something about the left-hand side pictorial. Coming to the right-hand side pictorial, it's mentioned master feeder structure. So guys, as we discussed, you know, there are funds which are, you know, domiciled or registered outside United States. So you need to understand they are just, you know, a pooling vehicle where they pull money from non-US investors, but they actually don't do any investments. So in this kind of structure, what you will see is at the top, it's investments. Let's go bottom to top. If you see the two circles in left and right hand side, there are US taxable investors who are putting money into a hedge fund, which is also called a feeder, and it is located in US. And on the right-hand side, there are foreign and non-US or US tax-exempt investors which are putting in into a hedge fund, which is called an offshore feeder, which is located outside US. And eventually, both these feeder funds put their money into master fund. Okay, so basically, the master fund is the one who does that investments. And whatever money is earned by the master fund is further then allocated to both the feeders. And then the feeders allocate that income to the investors. So it's basically very self-explanatory diagram. For master feeder, you should see from bottom to top, like how the money is bought into the feeder funds, and then from feeder funds to master funds, and then eventually investments are made, and whatever is profit is earned is been allocated to feeders. Okay, any questions so far, Zaki?
No.
Okay, we can move to the next slide.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Okay, so interesting. Who are the counterparties or players involved in their at their respective roles? So on the left hand side, it is more about, like, from the fund side, as we saw the earlier pictorial about the structure, where we saw, like, how investors put their money into the fund, and then fund invest, and then profit is allocated. So similarly, so on the fund side, there is a general partner, there is an investment manager, and of course there are investors who invest money. On the right hand side, you can see who are the you know, service providers to the hedge fund, and how they help it. I can just quickly go through, starting with brokers and custodian. Of course, the hedge funds are mainly into trading securities and exotic products, so they need brokers, they need custodians to park their assets, basically securities. In most of the cases, the brokers are itself custodians, but in some cases they are separate also. Then clockwise, the second one is fund administrator and transfer agent. So basically in hedge funds, you will see the overall accounting and financial reporting function has been outsourced to a third party, to name few, like Morgan Stanley, Citco, SNC Global, and so on. So there are big, big fund administrators who are doing work for hedge funds, and completely the accounting and financial reporting work is outsourced. Okay, so they are the fund administrators. So the hedge fund themselves don't even have an accountant also to do any accounting. It's totally outsourced to fund administrator. And this was basically introduced because the nature of investments that hedge funds are doing, and you know, the kind of risk they are handling. So it was required to have a third party, you know, who can, you know, do their accounting and valuations, not doing the valuations, but making sure, like, you know, everything is reasonable. They don't give an opinion or they don't confirm everything is fair or good, but still having a third party administrator helps to keep a check on overall corporate governance of a hedge fund. So you will, like 99.99% of the hedge funds would be having a third party fund administrator. Okay, the next one is auditors. Similar to other commercial entities, even the hedge funds are subject to audit. Some would be having a statutory requirement, some would be required as per the governing docs, which ask a annual statutory audit to be done. Banks, of course, they need banks for getting money from investors, paying out withdrawals to investors, paying out to the other service providers like auditors, fund administrators. The tax consultants, they do require tax consultants, basically, especially when they are in US, because, you know, so with respect to tax, this all entities are pass-through entities. They are not taxed directly, but the investors or the partners are taxed. So the hedge funds have to issue a statement which states like what is the income earned from the fund. And when individual investors file their return of income at that time, they will pay taxes on their own. Of course, attorney, the last circle, attorneys are required and are the stepping stone for any hedge fund to start, because they are the ones who draft the governing docs, which we will discuss in the next couple of slides. Like the operating agreements, the subscription document and everything. So attorneys is one of the you know, main pillar for an hedge fund to kickstart. Okay, so this, we talked about like counterparties and their respective roles. Before we move ahead, any questions, Zaki?
Yeah, there is a question. How is incentive allocation is done?
So incentive, as we discussed, is the industry percentage is around 20%. So for example, if fund earns or makes profit of $100, so 20% would be $20. So $20 would be retained by the investment manager or the general partner, and the balance $80 would be distributed among other investors. Okay.
And there is one more.
Sure.
Accounting for hedge funds comprises of how is it different from normal accounting for a manufacturing company?
So when you talk about United States general accepted accounting policies, so we have a altogether different accounting standard codification, which is ASC 946, that governs the accounting for an investment company, which is also like for the hedge funds. So if you ask me, like, there is no difference in as such, like, you know, like if you have to accrue something like a payable to auditor, you'll pass the same entry that you pass for an commercial entity. Yes, ASC 946 clearly mentions that the amounts reported on a particular date should be a fair value amount. Okay, so that is the major difference, whereas in other entities you don't fair value it, you do it on cost basis or other methodology. Fair value can also be done, but in investment companies like hedge fund, it is mandatory to fair value all the items that are on the balance sheet. So that is the major difference. Okay, I think we any other questions or we can move ahead?
There is one more. What is the role of seed money in hedge funds, if any?
So there is seed money. Basically, you will hear out that word not in hedge funds, but in other types of alternate investment funds like venture capital. So seed money is basically if any new business is starting up. So venture capital may infuse some money, and that money infused can be called as seed money. Okay. Let's move to the next slide,
Yeah.
please. Okay, so let's quickly discuss about governing documents. I'm sure, like, you know, more or less other entities also have this kind of governing documents, which is like the constitution or basis of forming any entity. So from the hedge fund incorporation purpose, if it's an entity which is a partnership, we'll see a limited partnership agreement, as we see in a memorandum of association, like name, object, place, and other things. So similarly, this kind of agreements include the objective, the name of the fund, and other important aspects to run hedge fund. In case of non-partnerships, you'll see operating agreement. Okay, so from the investor's perspective, so we have private placement memorandum. Basically, that's one kind of a marketing document. If someone is interested to invest in any fund, the investment manager would give a, you know, when they invest, they would give a private placement memorandum. It's nothing but summarizing the overall objective or the hedge fund strategy in a lucid manner so that the investors can understand. The important aspect is the limited partnership agreement and the private placement memorandum should be in sync. That is more important, and from the audit perspective, we have to take care about this. Also, side letter agreement. So basically, this is an agreement whenever a new investor invests, they have to abide with you know, the conditions, the 220 condition, etc., as per the you know, the limited partnership agreement. But in case if GP gives some concession or relaxation in any of the fees they charge normally to an investor, so to enter into that transaction or relaxation of fees would be done through a side letter agreement. From the regulator's perspective, of course, these entities are registered, you know, with the state bodies. Mostly in US, you'll see state of Delaware, where the entities are registered. And if there are offshore entities, like an offshore fund for any, like a feeder, they would be having some registration, and also along with that, registration certificate, a tax undertaking certificate from that particular regulatory body. For example, in Cayman, CIMA is the CIMA is the regulatory body. So they would be having some registration certificates, and with the local tax authorities of Cayman, they would be getting a tax exemption or tax undertaking certificate. With others, like, of course, when they are getting into agreements with fund administrators, they have an agreement with respect to brokers. Like when we deal in derivatives, there are certain aspects like offsetting. So to cover that, they have agreements with broker also called master netting agreements. Okay, I think we can move to the next slide, Saki, if no questions.
Yeah, we can.
Okay, so this is basically on hedge fund regulations and financials. So as I mentioned earlier, hedge funds are the loosely regulated entities, you know. So basically, that's the also reason like why the regulators doesn't want a common investor or a retail investor wants to invest into it, because they are loosely regulated. And when we say loosely regulated, that means, like, you know, the regulators does some kind of compliance, requires some kind of compliance, but not to that extent as for other companies or mutual funds. So in case like of regulation part, depending on the amount of assets in the hedge funds that is managed by an investment manager, some hedge funds may be required to get themselves registered with SEC. The threshold limit is at an investment manager level, which is around $150 million. If the investment manager is managing below $150 million, so there is no requirement as such to get registered with the SEC, and it's the investment manager who is getting registered with SEC and not the the individual fund. Okay. Once the investment manager is registered with the SEC, they have to you know, follow certain the funds have to follow certain regulations, like filing you know, certain forms with the regulators, also called form ADV. The funds have to issue their opinion and the financials at a certain timeline, by a certain timeline, for example, like 120 days from the year end, which is like around April 30th. And for some, they would be like 180 days based on their strategy and the investment. So basically this depends on the investment manager, how much assets they manage and how and what are the requirements as per regulator to for them depending on their assets and their management. Okay, I think with respect to other aspect of this slide, the financials, I think I just try to cover up like how a basic hedge fund financial looks like. I try to segregate it into different schedules and ending with the notes to accounts. So starting with statement of financial condition. So basically the statement of financial condition is also like known as a balance sheet. So now typically the balance sheet would be a very small balance sheet, considering on the asset side they would be heavy on investments and cash. So you'll see investments in long and short securities on the liability sides, and there would be hardly any accruals or other any liabilities, because normally hedge funds don't take loans and then invest. It's basically the investor's money. So the balance sheet is very super super small, like just having investments on the asset sides and liability sides, some accruals, like very immaterial amount, and the assets minus liabilities would be the net assets, which is like the funds total equity, like net equity held at a particular date. The second schedule is about statement of operations. So it says about there is a format for it. We have to bifurcate the whole income and expenses into two parts. One part would be the traditional investment income and expense. Like investment income includes interest income, dividend income, and investment expenses include like payment to auditors, administrators, legal fees, etc. So that is one part. The second part would be the realized gain and loss on investments made, which also includes the change in unrealized, because as we discussed, all the amounts on the balance sheet date are fair value. So the difference between the fair value and cost, if it is not sold, the change in unrealized gain loss has been impacted. Okay, so basically, yeah, the statement of operations consists of like, two main parts, the investment income and expense, and the second is realized and unrealized gain loss. The management fees, which is like 2%, which is based on the asset under management, would be seen in the investment expenses side. Performance fee, there is like, two way of disclosing performance fees, which is based on the structure of the entity. So if it's a partnership entity, it will be not expensed out in the statement of operations or P&L statement, but it will be shown in the statement of changes in partners' capital, where that amount would be reallocated from LP to GP. So, and if it's a non-partnership entity structure, in that case, performance fee will be shown as an expense similar to management fees. Okay, the next schedule, going to the next schedule, is condensed schedule of investments. So as the name suggests, it's basically summarizing the investments that are held by the hedge fund. Basically, it's segregated by geography and industry. So basically, if you understand from the perspective of reader of the financials or the prospective investor in the fund who would see that financials, they would like to know in which part of globe the fund has invested and in which sectors. So when I say sectors, that can be, manufacturing, consumer durables, transportation, hospitality. So, all the investments which the fund holds as of year-end date, they have to be segregated sector-wise and country-wise, and a condensed schedule has to be prepared. From the financial reporting perspective, we are also required to disclose any material securities in the front of CSY. So what is material? Material is basically any investments whose value is greater than 5% of the total assets under management. Those are the material securities, and they have to be shown separately on the condensed schedule of investments. when we show separately, we have to show like how many shares or units we hold of that company, the name of the company, and the fair value of the company. So that is a, you know, just an FYI to the reader of the financials, like how much they are exposed to which sector, which country, and also if there are any material securities, then which securities. Then the fourth schedule is about the cash flows. So I think it's the same as we see any other company's cash flow. The only difference is normally in a normal company, you will see state cash flows from operating, cash flows from financing, and cash flow from investing activities. But in case of hedge funds, you'll not have anything called as cash flow from investing activities, because their main operations or their main line of business is basically investing only. So whatever activities happens with regards to investments are being shown as cash flow from operating activities. Apart from that, whatever investments or whatever capital contributions or investment is made by investors has been disclosed in the financing activity. Okay. Moving to the next schedule, the statement of changes in net assets. So that is basically nothing but a roll forward of partners' capital or the roll forward of the net equity, starting with what was the capital at the start of the year, what was the contributions, what were the withdrawals, and what was the profit and loss allocated during the year, and which ends up to net equity, which should tie to your balance sheet. Moving to the last part of this slide is basically the notes to accounts, very critical and very important because accompanying notes are describing various significant accounting policies and various disclosures which are GAAP required by GAAP. So probably it starts with like organization note, like what is the fund, what is the strategy, who is the general partner, who is the investment manager, and also if there are any feeder funds and so on. So that is basically the first note, and then we have significant accounting policies where they define like each policy for their cash, for their investments, income tax policies, interest and dividend recording policies, and etc. This is like typical, like you see in any kind of entities which is not even a hedge fund. Now coming to the special disclosures with regards to hedge funds, there are certain gaps apart from ASC 946, it's ASC 820 and ASC 815, which requires a hedge fund to to disclose certain schedules. Basically the most important and the common schedule is bifurcating the whole investments into three categories: level one, level two, and level three. Level one being the most liquid assets and level three the most illiquid one, and the ones which are not falling in level one or level three are the level twos. So just to give you a few examples, like common stocks, investment in mutual funds, investment in exchange traded options, futures, they are all level one. Why? Because they are easily liquidable. But in case if the fund is making any investment in a private company or in a company or buying some shares which are not traded in exchange, they will be probably level threes because they're less liquid in nature. So it is very important, this table, as an investor, I would like to see like what is the fund assets and what is the liquidity condition of the fund. So the more level three heavier, the more the fund is illiquid. If there are no level threes, you can assume that the fund is liquid and the withdrawal restriction or redemption restriction would be less compared to an illiquid fund. Okay, at the end, we are also required to disclose certain returns for the year. So basically, it's a total return ratio, like what fund earned during the year, closing minus opening, and which is the denominator, and the numerator would be the P&L earned. There is a method for calculating for it. It's like not a simple average, but a geometric progression. And apart from total return ratio, we are also required to disclose certain other ratios, like expense ratios, which is the total expenses divided by average capital during the year. So these are the the highlighters of the financial statements of an hedge fund. I think if there are certain questions, we can take it right now before we move ahead.
Yeah, there are some questions. First question is, what are derivatives by risk?
Derivatives by risk. Okay, one second. So derivatives by risk is basically, when you deal into certain products, you have to be cognizant like what risk is associated with that product. So to name few risk like equity risk, credit risk, foreign exchange risk. So these are the most common risk. For example, if I am taking if options, you know, which is an underlying is an common stock equity, Tata Motors option, call option. So the risk over there in that derivatives is basically an equity risk. Any movement in the price of Tata Motors will change the value of the derivatives. If I buy an foreign exchange forward contract, so that the risk associated with that contract would be the foreign exchange risk. So that will be coming under FX risk. If I buy anything which is having you know, interest rate associated, like, you know, the value of the derivative will be will be impacted because of any change in interest, so that it's an interest rate risk. So this is these are the common risk which we see the products are associated with. It's also important to know, like, you know, for the reader of the financials, like, you know, when the objective of the fund is, you know, to invest into equities, you know, more and more equities. So if they see in the financials, like, you know, they have good amount of derivatives which are holding credit risk, so they can either, the existing investors can question the investment manager, or the prospective investors can accordingly make decisions if they are interested in to invest in a fund which are heavy on the credit risk side or the interest rate risk side.
Okay, so there is one more. Can we net off realized gain and loss and disclose it at net in order to avoid questions from investors?
Correct. So investors are more concerned about what was the net PNL at the end of the year. So the realized gain and loss is always net. We don't cross it up, like, what is the realized gain and what is realized loss. It's always a net amount that goes on the statement of operations.
Okay. And there's one more. Is the term of investment already disclosed at time of investing to investor? And how is standard ROI in HFS, or what is expected rate of return?
Good question. So there are two questions in this question. Basically, one is like term of an hedge fund. So basically, there is no as such term defined at when the hedge fund starts. They are typically existent till the GP wants to run or doesn't want to liquidate. Answer to the first question. Unlike private equity funds and venture capital funds, where there is a defined term like 10 years, 12 years, or 15 years, and hedge fund doesn't have any term as such. Answering to the second question about the rate of returns. So normally you need to understand, like, why would investors invest into hedge fund if the hedge fund is performing same as what market is performing, or, you know, what my fixed income securities which are risk-free are giving. So they have always an pressure to outperform the market, which is like giving more returns what the exchange return is, or what are the normal conventional investments returns are. So there is no single number to it, but if you ask me, like, considering in US market where the interest rates are now next to 0%, if a fund, you can assume like having 0% or 1% interest rate. If you want a loan, you can get it at 2% or 3%. If you invest in a fixed deposit, you get like hardly 1% interest or 2% interest. And if a fund is giving you 10% interest, you can understand the difference. You know, for us, 10% would not be a big number. But for a market like US, where the bank interest rate are between 0 to 2, 3%, and a fund performing next to 10 to 12% also, that means the fund is doing, you know, exceptionally well. For us, It sounds like if it is 50%, like in an Indian market, if it is 50%, okay, it makes sense, because if the fund is giving 8, 9, 10%, it's equivalent to a fixed deposit return. So why should I take so much risk to get only a return which is a risk-free return? Okay, so I hope I was able to answer this both term and the return thing. Any other questions before we move ahead?
Yeah, there is one more. What are differences between IFRS and US GAAP reporting for hedge funds?
So the US regulator allows the hedge funds to report their the, allows investment manager to report in any GAAP apart other than US GAAP, but there is a reconciliation required at the end of the financials, like for all the disclosures which are there or which are required or adjustments required in US GAAP but not in IFRS and vice versa. So I would say IFRS is more detailed. The detail of exposure, the number of disclosures are more compared to US GAAP. The one of the most important difference that I could recollect is basically in US GAAP, you have to reduce your net assets at the year end for any withdrawals or redemption that is happening on the first day of the next year, which is like Jan 1st. But whereas in IFRS, we are not doing that. So that is one of the major difference in US GAAP versus IFRS. Apart from that, of course, as I mentioned, there would be some additional disclosures compared to US GAAP, but more or less both are required to do on fair value basis. So in terms of net assets, you know, the fair valuation of investments, the valuation of investments is more or less same for hedge funds and IFRS, which is the most critical part of any hedge fund, the investments value. Any other questions before we move ahead?
Yes, there is. What is ASC? Secondly, what is difference between ASC and IAS?
So ASC is basically in US GAAP, that is accounting standard codification. And IAS is basically the IFRS part, the international accounting standards. So the IFRS 1, 2, 3, 15. Then there are other IAS who governs the IFRS framework. Whereas in US GAAP framework, we use ASC, which is the full form is accounting standard codification.
Yeah, I think that's all the questions. I think everyone is, everything is answered. We can move on.
Cool. I think we were pretty much able to understand, like, basics of hedge funds. What are the, what is hedge fund? How do hedge fund make money? How can, where they do make investments? What are the strategies, the geographic concentration, the financial of a hedge fund, how it looks like, and who are the counterparties that support the hedge funds? What are the structures? Now let's jump into auditing hedge funds. If you go to the next slide, you'll see I have tried to bring the overall auditing framework into one slide. More or less, if someone is doing hardcore audits, they will understand that the process that is mentioned over here from left to right would be more or less same as you do for other commercial entities or for any other audits, may it be Indian, may it be US, or may it be any under any framework. Okay. So starting with, the understanding the entity. So I'm sure everyone would be, knowing that, how important before we start anything to understand our entity in terms of, the fund structure, like how they are, they're structured and, the strategy of the fund and basically why this is important is you can determine your team, like, if there are any strategies which are requiring any specialist to value something, that you may need to obtain that resource to audit that particular hedge fund. So that is why, from that perspective also, understanding the entity is very important. Also to understand the regulatory aspect. Like, if the fund is exceeding, like, the total investment under management of an investment manager is greater than $150 million. So we come to know that, okay, because of this, there is a timeline to issue an opinion. So that this is also, major reason to an important reason to understand the entity at the start before, you get into the full-fledged audit. How can you do so? Understanding the entity could be, reading out the governing documents, as we discussed in the previous slides, like the limited partnership agreement, operating agreement, and other kind of governing documents. Independently going through regulator's website and see, like, what clients have uploaded, like, as like normal filings, compliances, like every quarterly or every yearly, half yearly, they have to do some reporting to the regulators. So this will give more insights. Who are the related parties? Because if they are registered with the regulator like SEC, they have to report it on an annual basis. So this all things would be a good source to understand, you know, what is entity. Like understanding the entity part would be easy and will help in overall audit procedures. So once we are done with understanding the entity, we know now what is the strategy of the fund. We know what investments the fund is making. We know what are the regulatory requirements. We can now move on to the next phase called planning phase. So before going to planning phase also, like there are other sources of information in understanding the entity. You can always ask, you know, a hedge fund to provide their, provide their organization chart, may it be employee, the personal organization chart or overall organization chart, understanding who are the administrators, brokers, bankers, and you know, so on. So the source of information, collecting the source of information is, are many to get a understanding, like, you know, what is the entity. Then moving to the next phase, planning. So once you know, like, what is the entity, what are the investment strategy, what are the products they deal in, what is the regulatory requirements? So now you can plan your audit, you can plan your audit team, you can draft an engagement letter where the scope of services is defined, like what you will be doing, and so on, and you can move ahead. Okay, and you can inquire the contact details of the administrators, brokers, bankers, because there would be certain phases of audit where you will be required to confirm that some information independently. So you can all cover this under the planning stage. Of course, this would be done like by doing some meetings internally and also with the clients that you are auditing. So, you know, you get better understanding and you can also freeze out certain things like timelines and etc. In the planning stage, we would also like to do in some analytical procedures, as simple as that, comparing the current year's, interim numbers with the last year numbers and seeing like, if everything is in usual or if anything is unusual or exceptional item, so that we can focus on that area and design our audit process or our programs accordingly based on our analysis or based on results of the analytical procedures. So once you are done with planning, I think internal control is also part of the planning stage, like where you try to understand the internal controls designed, whether they are effectively designed, if they are implemented, as they are supposed to be. So in that case also, like, it's very important to obtain, or first to understand what are the key processes in that hedge funds. Typically, if you see from the perspective of uniqueness, I think more or less the hedge funds have same key processes. Like, to name few is like basically the key process would be investments, the capital activities like invest, withdrawals, contribution. They are the key processes, the IT general controls. So all that stuff we need to understand before we move ahead and design our audit testing part. So based on the internal controls, you will understand like, you know, how effectively they are designed and if they are designed and implemented. So to gain a comfort on the internal controls, what we can do is we can perform certain walkthroughs, which is the next step. And what do you mean by walkthrough is basically if client is saying that if I want to buy a security and if that security has like that buying part has to go certain processes as per the internal control narratives, you have to make sure all that processes or controls are met. As example, like if it says like, you know, it needs an investment manager approval. So we need to make sure, need to pick any random buy transaction and see like if the investment manager approved it, what price and what date it was approved. Was it bought at the same price and date when it was bought at the year end, whether it was reconciled with the broker's transaction or not, books and broker transaction. So all these controls needs to be seen if they were followed and get a comfort. So that is basically the job of a walkthrough, like where we get control of, like where we see that the controls are running effectively. So as I mentioned, the key processes are the investments and the capital activities. So in investments, we would like to see the buy and sale part approval, the trade reconciliation, as we discussed, the capital activities. We'd like to see who is responsible for anti-money laundering procedures. So we'll see like what things were done on the AML side Also, what are the approval processes, like if there are any requests for withdrawals, like does GP has to approve? If yes, is there any approval letter or an email? So all that comes under the walkthrough part. And once we are having a satisfactory, comfort, yeah, whatever controls were there and for the random samples that controls were applied, I think we can then decide the scope of our substantive testing. And if we are extensively testing the internal controls, maybe we would do less substantive testing. But if we are not relying on internal controls and just understanding the internal controls and just doing one walkthrough, maybe our reliance on substantive testing would be high and we would be testing more compared to if you would have relied on the internal controls. So in terms of substantive testing, I think if we talk about the first and the important line item on the balance sheet is cash and due from broker. That's very fragile in nature, and it's very important to get it confirmed independently. So for this, what we will do is, like, for all the bank accounts open during the year or closed during the year, we would like to confirm it independently from the bankers. Same thing from brokers. Brokers would be also, apart from payables and receivables from brokers, they would be also having some securities at the year end. We would like to see that securities which broker shows is also reflected in the client's portfolio, and vice versa. If client is telling that I hold like 50 shares of Apple or 50 shares of any other security, that should be reflected in the broker statement. So basically that's what we will do as part of investment testing, investment substantive testing. Apart from existence, what we will also do is the valuation part. As we discussed earlier also, fair value is the prerequisite for hedge funds. So we need to make sure all the investments are valued properly and are at fair value. As an auditor, I would like to get the pricing from an independent source rather than just relying on the broker or the client. I would search from the exchanges what was the last traded prices as of the reporting date, which is normally December 31st, the last date of the year. Or maybe I reach out or maybe I obtain pricing from Bloomberg, Reuters, and any other sources as allowed. And as agreed during a planning phase, like from where we will get the pricing, what will be the pricing source. Then after investment testing, we have revenue testing. The only and the biggest part of revenue for a hedge fund would be realized gain loss and the unrealized change in unrealized gain loss. So what is realized gain loss is basically if you buy something and sell at a future date, the profit earned is called as a realized gain loss. So we will like to do certain testing, maybe on sample basis, because there would be like thousands of transactions in a year. I would like to use a sample methodology where I select 100 or 50 samples and trace it with broker if everything is correctly calculated as per their report, and gain a comfort on the revenue part also. Since everything is fair valued, so of course in statement of operation we'll see something called as change in unrealized. That is nothing but fair value minus cost. Until and unless that security is sold off, whatever increase or decrease in value is there will be reflected in the change in unrealized gain loss part. Okay, so that is about the revenue testing. You may like to test certain operating expenses, payment to administrators, payment to auditors, or payments to any other vendors like legal attorneys, just as you do expense testing for any other entities. So that is something. So in that operating expenses, you will do that testing. Anything, guys, which is related to any expense, any line item or any head which is related to related parties or affiliates, we will be testing that. For example, management fees and performance fees, though the amount would be small in nature, but still we would be testing them because they are associated with an affiliate. The hedge fund investment manager is getting into it. There are chances if the frauds can be done to earn more, because they are basically investment managers doesn't have any other source of revenue apart from this 220 investment management fees and the performance fees. Also, you need to understand like why the valuation part is very important. For example, if I am valuing certain investment at $100, whereas the value is only $10, so I'm overvaluing by $90, so that will result in overall increase my profit, and which will eventually increase the performance fee for my investment manager. So that to avoid this kind of frauds, it's very important to retest the performance fee and the management fees during the year. And so I think apart from these three areas, the capital activities portion, we need to make sure whatever profit is earned. So in a hedge fund, there will be like 50, 100, 200, 300 investors. So all the profit has been allocated properly to all the investors on a monthly or a yearly or a quarterly basis, whatever the fund accounting methodology is, like the period of the period can be monthly, quarterly, or even half yearly. Mostly it is seen on monthly basis. So we need to, as an auditor, it is also important to check, like if the fund has earned $100, if that $100 has been distributed correctly among the 100 investors or 50 investors in the ratio of the capital contribution in the fund. So that is one of the most important substantive testing that we need to do. The auditing hedge fund would be, you know, at the end, of course, we have to issue an opinion, which will be foreign financial statement that the client has prepared, containing all the schedules that we discussed in the previous slides and accompanied by the notes to accounts. So we need to make sure the financial statements are GAAP compliant. When we say GAAP compliant, that means all the disclosures that are required are made, and all the policies, etc., which are required to be disclosed are disclosed, and so on. So basically, so that's the role of auditor, to make sure that the FS is GAAP compliant. Apart from that, in the closing engagement, when you are closing the audit, you need to make sure that you do a final analytical procedures just to make sure that the year-end numbers and the last year's numbers, if there are any unusual differences or variances between any in any of the accounting or the line item of balance sheet and P&L, need to further investigate and make sure like the variance is substantiated with the reason, the material variance. So that is something we do. Subsequent events, guys, the year-end date and the issuance of opinion would be, of course, there would be a gap of at least 2 to 3 months or 4 months. So we also, as a gap requirement, we need to disclose what were the subsequent material events happening, which also needs to be disclosed in the financial statements. So that is something, once we are clear with all this, then the auditors can issue an opinion based on their testing results. They will opine whether there are any qualifications or no qualifications, any disclaimers or any emphasis of matter. So based on the testing procedures performed, they will be opining on the same and issuing an opinion. So I think it was very much theoretical, but I think this is the whole phase of an hedge fund audit, starting with understanding the entity, doing the planning stuff, then internal controls part, then doing the walkthroughs, then doing the substantive testing for all the key accounts, and at the end doing the financial statements and closing procedures. Okay, Zaki, any questions so far?
Yeah, we move ahead. Okay. Yes, there is one question. Yeah. Regulatory environment in India, is it SEBI only, or there are any other authorities?
So with respect to India, based on my limited knowledge, there are regulations for alternate investments, which is again regulated by SEBI. So there are regulations, and SEBI regulates it. In India, we so as per the Indian structure, there are like three types of funds, type 1, type 2, and type 3. So typically, hedge fund would come under type 3. Basically, they can short and like whatever strategies they have typically comes under the type 3 fund. Okay, yeah, and to answer that question, SEBI is the one who has prepared regulations for alternate investments. Any other questions?
No, that's the only one. We can proceed with
So it's SEBI AIF regulation 2012. It was formed in 2012, and since then there are many updates, amendments happening, but yeah, SEBI AIF regulations 2012.
And there is one more question just came. how far the hedge funds are emerging in India?
As I said, if you ask me the total percentage, it will not be only not even 1% of the total hedge funds in the global market. But things are picking up, considering the overall economy doing good so far it was, and I'm sure it will be doing good in the coming months, and overall upliftment and the income earning and all that stuffs would be taking this growth of hedge funds in India to a next level. But so far it's not that big in terms of asset under management. And I'm sorry, I don't have exact numbers like how much hedge funds in India manage, but I'm sure it would be a very small amount. You already have regulations for it, so everything is set up. It's only like the new hedge fund managers have to come up, and the investors should be ready to invest into it. Of course, meeting the requirements as set by SEB for even in India, we have certain net liquidity and income criteria to be part of these hedge funds, and the minimum subscription amount also. I just want to, if you can unmute and if someone can speak, like from the audience, like how is it going? Like, are you going to slow down or is it going well enough, understandable? Or like, if you can unmute and just take some feedbacks.
So guys, do you have any doubts? Do you want to get clear? Any feedback? How is the session going on?
Yeah, the session is very good. This is Nirmala here, Zaki. The session is excellent. Thank you very much for this. And what I have to ask is, it's a question basically. This will not only help us do our exams, it'll also help us practically. So would you be sharing the recording after this, or only the slides will be shared?
Yeah, sure. I'll be sharing the slides and I'll be sharing the session itself.
Okay. And another question for Ankit is that, do you actually practically work in a hedge fund, doing the accounting for hedge funds itself?
Yes, I did financial reporting and I also audit hedge funds.
In India?
I work under the US GAAP framework in India. Okay. From India, yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Any other questions, feedback, guys? Thanks, Nirmala.
Yeah, hi, Ankit. This side, Arun Sethi. So,
hi, Arun.
Yeah, hi. So, I would like to have, do you have few memorandums on complex topics which hedge funds are facing right now because of accounting changes?
So in the US GAAP framework, there is as such no change since couple of years. There will be always new additional disclosures to be made as per the the local regulators over there. But as such, there is no change, a significant change in accounting. There is an update on the hedging part, but as I said, like this, hedge funds are not into actual hedging. So they just buy securities for the sake of doing a speculative gain loss. So more or less, the accounting remains same as you see for any other particular manufacturing company also buying a security or selling a security. But of course, they have to present certain additional disclosures what a manufacturing company will not be.
Accounting changes, and then I am asking for, like we have in IFRS, we have a lot of changes from IAS. Like for leases, we have IAS 17 earlier and now we have IFRS 16. In US GAAP or accounting standard codifications, there are no such changes. Like we have ASC 842 and we have ECL model, those kinds of things I am asking.
So basically, this hedge funds are basically pass-through entities. So when we say the 220 model, so they don't have any assets, fixed assets, neither there is any lease agreement for the hedge funds, nor there is any, salaries in the statement of operations. So this all has been taken care of by an investment company for which the hedge fund gives them a 2% of the total asset under management. So the lease accounting, the new revenue recognition, etc., nowhere adds any changes to the hedge fund financials or a disclosure. I hope I'm able to.
Yeah, you are right. You are right. But lot many times we have received queries from the client that we have to identify first of all whether it is a pass through entity, and if it is a pass through entity, what will be the accounting, subsequent accounting, and what will be the treatment of derivatives. So we receive such kind of queries, and there are lot many agreements which are passed by the clients to us, and we have to go through the agreements, and it is not very easy to identify whether this is a pass through entity or a feeder.
So Arun, like before we move it, like you are currently auditing hedge fund or doing fund accounting service for
I am issuing technical memorandums for my clients.
Which clients, like hedge funds or any other clients?
Financial FS clients, financial services.
And they are serving which market? US or Indian market?
US.
Okay. So Arun, how about like we connect after this session? I can share you my number, and probably you know, I'll give my Sanjeevni and Zaki has my number. You can take from them, and we can reconnect and see what exactly, you know, how I can help you if anything.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Ankit, this is Nirmala here. I have another question. Yeah. Coming back to what Arun was asking, I just am thinking. So you mean to say the IFRS 9 does not have any impact on this accounting?
So I'm sorry, for the IFRS, as per my limited knowledge. So in the US cap, is ASC 820, ASC 815, which talks about fair value measurements and the derivative disclosures, the ASC 815. I don't know the exactly corresponding IFRS for that. So it's not all the IFRS which has an impact on hedge funds, but if it is related to investments or fair value of investments, of course, they are applicable for hedge funds.
Okay, I have some questions around this. If I connect to you after this, and just clarify those. Yeah. Thank you.
Sure. Yeah.
And there is one more question by Ritik. He's asking, mutual funds have NAV for valuation. How are hedge funds valued while investing? What am I buying, units or just a gross amount?
That's a very beautiful, good question. So Ritik, so there are like different types of structure of an hedge fund. You know, an investment manager can set up a hedge fund, which is basically a limited partnership where you don't issue any units, but it works like a normal partnership. So in that case is, if you want to invest in an hedge fund, you'll be putting a lump sum amount, like say $200,000, $500,000. And there will be no as such units issued, but you will be getting a partnership interest in percentage terms. So for example, if there are already five partners within $100,000 and you put additional $10,000, so now that $110,000 divided by six partners, you'll get the partnership interest. Okay, so that is one kind of structure. The another structure is basically you have where it is like a limited by shares. So, you know, the operating agreement of the this type of entity would be defining what is the par value of per share and what was the premium. So every share issued, for example, is issued at $1,000. So if you are putting like $10,000, you will be given 10 shares. So accordingly, whatever net assets has been calculated on the reporting date, that would be divided by the total number of shares issued so far, and you will derive the share per value. Value per share. I'm sorry. So is this answers your question, Ritik?
Hi, Ankit. Hello.
Hi. Yeah, who is this?
Hi, I'm Jalpa here. And I have a question about registration with SEC. Earlier, you said that the hedge funds are hedge fund managers, actually, if they are registered with SEC, they have to comply with some more requirements. So is there any requirement where hedge funds itself have to be registered with SEC?
So as such, there is no requirement with respect to hedge funds to get registered. As I said, like they are the most loosely regulated entities. It's the investment managers who are registered, that too they have an option or exemption, you can say, like if they are managing the, so an investment manager can manage like 3 hedge funds or 5 or 10 also at a time. If the consolidated amount under management is greater than $150 million, so they have to be now actively if it is more than that, they have to actively get it registered, they have to follow the custody rules, they have to follow the timeline rules and other rules specified. But if the hedge funds are very, very big in nature, when I say very big means, you know, $1 billion, like $10 billion, $20 billion, so there are other regulations, like, you know, like called PF reporting, private fund reporting. So where they have to abide with that kind of reporting, where they have to do a quarterly or half yearly submissions to the regulators. But the small hedge funds as such, like, you know, which are around $1 billion to $2 billion, they are not required to get themselves registered and not to do any other compliance, and everything is done at the investment manager level.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
And there is one more question by Gopal. Hello, sir. Is this investment fund benefits for CMA or CPA beneficial in examination point of view? Or else, if I want to work with this accounting, then which post will I get to work with HR funding?
So you will appreciate, like, you know, India is a big market who is servicing this kind of hedge funds. And the biggest players in this hedge fund industries are the administrators, where, you know, all the well-standing reputation administrators have their presence in India, may it be in Mumbai, Bangalore, or Hyderabad. So normally they have certain criteria in terms of qualification before they take. I'm just assuming, like, starting with the administrator's part. So they would require either to be a chartered accountant or MBA from a decent B school. Nowadays, I've also seen a recently big, not a big four, but the big five or big six, which has opened up in Bangalore. They have also started hiring CPA and is being treated like equivalent to a CA degree. So I think CPA is a good, if you are not a chartered accountant, I would suggest to, you know, go ahead and do CPA. And this will help you to entering into this kind of servicing firms which are serving the hedge fund industry. Talking about the audit firms perspective, like big fours, apart from big fours, there are other top 20, top 30 funds that are mainly into hedge funds auditing and other financial services. Over there also, like, CA is a prerequisite in the audit function. If you are not a CA, I think CPA is equivalently, you know, acceptable. So for to answer that question, I think if you ask me between CPA and CMA, I think CPA would be a better choice. And then I leave up to you, what other things you have in mind, like what is the objective of doing certain things.
Okay.
I think if there are no further questions, yeah, we can mute some distance.
I think we can take a break now. I think all the other
questions. One small question.
At the end.
Small question.
Okay, there is one more thing by Ritik. He's asking, it is know that hedge fund has loose regulations. So how is the investor money protected from any kind of fraud? Or is it the pain or gain game? Either you lose all or win some.
So when I say loosely regulated, that doesn't mean like the investment manager on its own, without any governance part, they will do anything. That's why there is a third party administrator to take care about discipline in terms of valuation, accounting and other stuffs. And there is a clause in their operating agreement that once in a year annually there should be an audit done. So with respect to valuations and, you know, the balance sheet items at the reporting date or the P&L reported for a year, that's where they get audited. With regards to strategy of the fund, they may be loosely regulated, but there's something called GIPS. So some investment managers would be loving to get a, you know, GIPS compliance, GIPS. So for that, they have to abide with certain, standards in reporting their performances. The biggest fraud which I can see that the investment manager can, you know, report their performances for last couple of years incorrectly or not in a manner which is, you know, in a calculated correctly. So for all that things, there is a risk. That's why regulators doesn't want a normal investor or a common investor to get into it. And typically you will see like HNIs, but mostly the funds are held by big institutions like FIIs and, you know, the sovereign funds and the pension plan funds, where they do have their own due diligence team who does this due diligence for the hedge funds. So it's they themselves do this periodically post due diligence after investments to take care if nothing wrongdoing has been done by investment manager. And as I mentioned, there are like other standards like GIPS, G-I-P-S, Global Investment Performance Standard. So if an investment manager is claiming that they are GIPS compliant, which is a good marketing thing for an investment manager, because if they say that they are GIPS compliant, the more comfortable the investors would be. So, and you can attract more money. So if for being compliant, they have to follow certain standards with respect to disclosures, comparability, consistency and transparency. And this all things consolidated where we can say that, you know, it is a risky affair, but not that kind of risk where the GP or the investment manager can do at the virtue of his, any decision making, which is not in a good intention. I think someone was having some questions. So probably if you can take it that quickly.
Yeah, there is one Harshad. I think he's trying to ask some questions. Yeah, Harshad.
Basically, that's a very good session we have attended. It's really going good. I'm totally new to this hedge funds and all, so it's very proving out to be fruitful to me. But how we can, like, if this topic seems quite interesting, and how we can further move into it in learning about this. So I guess there it was very informational session, but if you want to go further and read about it further, so how we can go?
So this is like a very niche industry. I'm sure like the best source would be surfing on the internet. And I tried to make my PPT more exhaustive. In the coming slides, you will see like, you know, the information is more, and I'll be speaking less because it is self-explanatory. But apart from that, the good resource material for studying hedge funds would be basically either you can buy a material from AICPA. There's an investment guide available, so you can for a reading purpose, it's very well explained, like how the investment funds should be structured, operated, or accounted, or disclosure perspective. Each and everything has been taken care of. Like, for example, if like in India, if I talk about, there is a guidance book on bank audits, example.
So similarly,
AICPA issues every year, even soft copy and hard copy, which discloses everything about the investment companies. Also, it includes product knowledge, also the disclosure part, also any technical questions which were asked to AICPA and they answered to it. So that will be like the Bible of investment companies or the, you know, alternate investment funds.
They actually tell us the basically the practicals of the hedge funding also. If someone wants to go and pursue their career in investment banking also.
No, this is more perspective from the accounting and financial reporting side. In terms of like career in hedge funds, I'm not sure if you're talking about like being an analyst or on the buy side, sell side, then I don't think so. AICPA book would be useful. Then I think getting some knowledge of our products and overall, I think the crux in hedge fund would be product knowledge and how products are traded in a market, so, or an exchange. That is the knowledge requirement. So I'm not very clear with your question, like you're talking about from the accounting or financial reporting perspective or from the trading side.
So this session is much more for accounting and financial reporting purposes, right? If I'm not getting it wrong.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's thank you so much. That's also my
purpose. Ankit, what is the book name? Sorry.
So it's Investment Guide.
Investment Guide. Thank you.
Okay. I think Zaki, we can start. I think there's one question. Like.
Yeah, there is one question. Whether fund accounting the same buzzword as hedge fund accounting?
Same buzz as fund accounting. let me frame this as like, you know, what we are speaking about, like hedge fund accounting and the fund accounting is same. Then if it is for hedge fund, I think, yes, it is same. But when you say fund accounting, what kind of fund do you try to say? If you can clarify in your question, and then only I can answer you more clearly. Okay. I think, yeah, if you can just move Zaki to the next slide,
yes.
We can start with the fund of funds. Okay. So by the name itself, fund of funds. So, you know, what is fund of funds? Like, you know, you understood, we just discussed about the hedge fund. So it's one fund. What do hedge funds do is like they invest in common stocks, other type of securities, exotic products, derivatives, and earn appreciation and earn money for their investors and distribute to them. And the investment manager takes some management fees and performance fees. Maybe Zaki, you want to mute everyone like before we open up again?
Yeah, I think I have muted everyone.
Okay, fine. Okay. Yeah. So now what is fund of fund? So fund of fund is basically, let's take an example, A. A is a hedge fund, and A is investing in another fund called B. So if A is a hedge fund and B, A is also again investing in another hedge fund called B, that A will be called as a fund of funds, as simple as that. Okay. So a fund of funds is also referred to as a multi-manager investment. Is an investment strategy in which a fund invests in other type of funds. This strategy invests in a portfolio that contains different underlying assets instead of investing directly in bonds, stocks, and other type of securities. The fund of fund strategy aims to achieve broad diversification and appropriate asset allocation with investments in a variety of fund categories that are all wrapped into one fund. Fund of fund characteristics attract small investors who want to get better exposure with fewer risks compared to directly investing in securities. And fund of fund may be mutual fund, a hedge fund, a private equity, or any investment trust. So guys, from this, what we understand is basically, let's take an example from the investor perspective. So investor is an accredited investor and eligible to invest in any hedge fund. But again, as I mentioned earlier, also every hedge fund has minimum subscription amount criteria, which would be ranging from $100,000 to $1 million. And that accredited investors want to diversify his portfolio as much as he can. As we discussed in the earlier slides, that the strategies of the fund can be long, short, can be event driven, can be diversified, can be multi-strategy, and so on. So how do he optimize his $250,000 that he has in his hands? So to do that, instead of investing in just one hedge fund, which is directly buying securities and or other types of derivatives, what that investor can do is can invest in a fund which further invests into multiple funds of multiple strategies. So in this way, he can meet his minimum subscription criteria with his limited resources of $250,000. And also at the same time, he can diversify and allocate his asset so that he can reap out the benefit from different strategies. So as simple as that, a fund investing in another fund is called fund of fund. And why is it doing so is basically to attract small investors who wants to get or who wants to optimize the value of the capital that they are holding. Okay, I think that's the fund of funds overview. We can move to the next slide.
Yes.
Yeah. So with respect to valuations of fund of funds. Okay. So fund of fund valuation other respects. So typically, you know, if a fund is investing into another hedge fund, which is also an investment company as per the accounting standard codification 946. So in everyone is able to see the PPT, right? Or no?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so basically, as I mentioned, a fund investing in another fund who is also an investment company as defined by accounting standard codification 946, So in that case, they can value that investment based on the proportion holding in that fund. For example, if you see the diagram, all the investors are infusing money in fund, which is called as fund of funds. They are further putting their money into other funds, which can be a hedge fund, a private equity fund, or a venture capital fund, or anything else. And they would be also having some value at a reporting date. So whatever the fund of fund holding is there in the subsequent investee funds, that in that proportion, they can value that investments. For example, in the chart, we have the first private equity fund, say $100,000 is the net asset value or net equity as of 12/31. And the fund of fund is holding 10% of it. So it's a simple math calculation. They can just do $100,000 into 10%, which is $10,000. And that would be valuation of that particular investment. But this is subject to certain criterias to be met by the fund of fund as well as the private equity fund. And the most important criteria is the investee funds should be an investment company, which is following the ASC 946 guidelines, the Accounting Standard Codification 946. So if that's the case, I think the valuation part of funds, which the fund of fund has invested, is very simple and straightforward. If not, then you have to use the different valuation approach that we will see in the private equity. What are the different approaches to value an investment which can't be valued, for which the value can't be derived either from exchanges or can't be valued at NAV, as we discussed in fund of funds. Okay, so typically fund of funds are close-ended funds. They may be having a certain defined term or may not be having. By close-ended funds is basically the fund of funds gets into agreement with other investee funds also, where they commit that they will put this much money at a certain, whenever there is a capital call. Similarly, they get into agreements with their investors and ask for a capital commitment. And once the capital commitment requirement is fulfilled, they may close the fund, and it will be run with the number of investors and investments will be consistent in the coming years. So that's the major difference between hedge fund, whereas in hedge fund, it's an open-ended fund. If an investor wants to invest after the fund is opened after 3 years, they can come in, invest. If the investor wants to go out of the fund after 5 years of the fund startup, they can go it. But in case of fund of funds, it's more or less similar to a private equity, where there is a commitment of amount as well as the withdrawals are restricted. You can't withdraw it. The only money that you can get from fund of fund is basically if the fund is distributing some money to their investors, and it will be doing so only if they receive some distributions from the underlying investee funds. So just when I'm speaking, just see the diagram. When I say investee funds, they are the private equity funds. So private equity funds distributing something to the fund of funds, eventually the fund of fund would be distributing to the investor. That is the only source of money that the investors can expect. They can't withdraw their money. If in case for some reasons they are not able to continue with it, they have to find a person from a market and who is ready to take the interest. Like, there will be a transfer of interest, no impact on fund of funds capital, but one A investor finding someone in the market and transferring his interest to B. So more or less the fund commitments are freezed, the capital commitments both on both sides from the investor side also, and most of the times the fund of funds commitment to the private equity funds also. Typically in fund of funds, since they are investing in further funds, they would like to have an investment or valuation committee. You will not see normally in a hedge fund having this kind of committee. Why it is important? Because they have to do a post due diligence with respect to funds they have invested to make sure whatever strategy was defined at the, or what the object was defined at the start of the fund is been met. And there are no corporate governance issue. The financials and the reporting is GAAP compliant. So for all this matters, there is an investment or valuation committee who takes care about, the funds overall working. So as I mentioned, the return of capital, basically, if you see the investee funds in this diagram, are typically a private equity funds. So private equity funds we'll discuss in the next coming slides. It's nothing but investing in an operating company with a certain set of amount to make sure the company get funds, and maybe in future the private equity funds can exit from that company by finding a new investor, and whatever money they have invested and whatever money they have got, the difference would be the realized gain loss. and that will be reaped by the investors, in this case fund of fund. So whenever there is, like, for example, a private equity having 10 funds, like 10 investments, and it is made for 10 years. So at the almost when the private equity funds comes into a maturity stage, like 8th year, 9th year, they will be starting liquidating their investments. So after liquidation, whatever money they receive, of course, keeping aside some portion for the investment manager as a performance fee or carried interest, and keeping some money aside for the operating expenses, they will distribute that money to funds. And that funds will be eventually distributed to investors. So that is basically called off return of capital. The funds may record it as a, like, return of capital and just reduce their cost of investment. Some funds may be, like, on their income statement would like to book some realized gain loss, basically to the proportion of the market value and cost at the date of distribution. So there are, like, different accounting policies for it. The other FS disclosure in additions to what we see in hedge fund is basically for all the investments that are made in another funds, like private equity or hedge funds, it is important to make sure to mention in the fund of fund financial statements, like, what strategies the fund is having, and basically what is the management fee rate, incentive fees rate, and what other things are material to be known to the investors of the fund of fund. So that is something one. Look through analysis, like, as we saw in the condensed schedule of investments in a hedge fund, anything which is a material security, which is greater than 5% of the net assets, we need to disclose it separately on the financials. So similarly, any holding of fund proportionately, it is greater than 5% of the fund assets, then it has to be disclosed separately, either in the notes to accounts or in the schedule of investments. So that is something, a look-through analysis. As we discussed, like, about the commitment amounts, there are commitment amounts to the investee funds also. They have to commit, and the same has to be disclosed in the financial statements, like what is the funded commitment, unfunded commitment, and so on. And in the hedge funds, we saw that we disclosed the total return ratio, but in case of fund of funds, since the term is defined, the set of investors are fixed, it is a closed-ended funds. So in that case, we don't show total return ratio, but we show an internal rate of return, which is nothing but the inception till date, the return that the fund has earned. So that is a more appropriate return disclosure rather than total return ratio. Total return ratio only considers the yearly return, what the fund has earned, but the IRR is, like, what the fund has earned since inception. And it totally makes sense because the investors are not the ones which are going and coming, but they are fixed at the start when the fund of fund was started and are there till the end of the fund of fund. So IRR is a better picture in terms of ratio, the total return ratio. Okay. I think that was something about fund of funds. Before we move ahead, any questions you want me to address?
There are no questions, sir.
Okay, great. Moving to the next slide. Private equity. Okay, so guys, as we discussed about hedge funds, starting with alternative investment funds and hedge funds overview, and then fund of fund overviews, I will quickly run through, like, private equity. I would basically just mention about the features of the private equity, how the structure is of a private equity fund, what are the differences between a hedge fund and private equity fund, classification and stages of private equity investments, and the valuation approaches at the end. So typically, starting with, like, what is private equity and private equity funds features. So as we discussed, private equity are the funds that are basically, you know, investing into other operating companies and not rather than buying something from the secondary market, like in hedge fund does, but they directly do an investment through a, like, something called PIPE, private investment in a public enterprise or maybe a non-public enterprise. So basically it's a collective investment scheme used for making investments in various equity securities according to one of the investment strategies associated with the private equity. Private equity funds are typically limited partnerships with a fixed term of 10 to 12 years. The investors in the private equity funds, again, like maybe HNIs, the accredited investors, but mostly you'll find sovereign funds, or basically the pension funds investing into this private equity funds with having a big risk appetite. And this all funds, guys, please understand, like, they have huge pool of money. So like $100 million. So even if they lose something in investing a private equity fund, like say $2 million, it's like not even 2%, like only 2% of their total pool money. So they have the huge risk appetite to, you know, play with this investments, private equity funds. As per practical aspect, like if you invest, track a performance or a track a, 10 private equities at the same time for a period of a, like 5-10 years, you will see out of 10, 8 would be not doing good. At the end, you have to either compromise in terms of, you know, getting less payments what you have invested, or you have to sometimes write off also. But there are, like, you know, only 2 or 3 private equities investments which, you know, reap you good benefits and cover up the other losses that are made for the 8 other investments. So having a big pool of money, having a huge risk appetite, they go systematic way and they do invest in private equity funds, venture capital funds, and other type of alternate investment funds. Okay. Coming to the legal status, you know, most private equities, with regards to private equities, the funds are structured as limited partnership, as I mentioned, and are governed by the terms set forth in their operating agreements, also called as limited partnership agreements. They raise capitals, you know, from cash-rich institutional investors, our pension plans, or universities, insurance companies, foundations, endowments, plan, and high-net individuals, which invest in the private equity as limited partners or like as an investor. And, you know, what has been the strategy disclosed by the private equity investment manager or general partner, on if they are agreeing to that strategy, they will invest into it. The term of the partnership, as mentioned, is like, you know, roughly 10 to 12 years. They will be extended by like a couple of years till they liquidate all the investments. That is being, that should be clearly mentioned in the operating agreement, that once the 10-year term is over, then it can be increased by multiple of 2 years. So unless and until all the assets are liquidated, there is no reason for a private equity fund to get closed down. Okay. Again, the management fees ranges from 1 to 2%, which is fixed in nature, and typically it is taken on a monthly or quarterly basis by the GP to run the operation of private equity. In hedge funds, we have seen performance fee, but in private equity, instead of performance fee, there is something called carried interest, because as we understood, the number of investments are fixed, the number of investors are fixed. It's not like you can come anytime and go anytime, and it's not like you can sell any investment today or buy something today and sell something today. So everything has a timeline of, let's say, roughly 10 years. So the carried interest is basically calculated from inception, whereas the performance fees is seen on a yearly basis. Like at the start, I had $100. At the end, I had $150. So $50 is the income earned. Take the 20% and distribute the rest. But in case of private equities, the inception to date returns are seen. Like, what are the inception to date returns? And if there are positive returns, then only GP can take some money. Okay. So management fees, of course, it's there in the hedge funds as well as in private equity, but in case of performance fee, the arrangement is different in both of the cases. Okay. So you can see the diagram of the private equity fund. There is a sponsorer at the start, just to kickstart the private equity funds. They raise money from the investors. There's an investment advisor to the private equity fund, and then the portfolio companies are the ones in which the private equity fund invest. Okay. So we can go to the next slide to understand more, like if there are any other differences apart from performance fees that we discuss between hedge funds and private equity funds. So starting with the first part, the first point is cash invested. Of course, hedge funds is like upfront, but in private equity funds, it's over the period of the time. Why? Because when the fund, the private equity fund is starting, they would be taking commitments from individual investors, but it's not like they will take the whole money at the day one, because actual mobilization of that money would depend on the capital requirement from the investee funds, the portfolio companies. So as and when portfolio companies demand money or they ask for money, at that point of time, the private equity fund will do a capital call from the investors and accordingly manage their cash, and so that their IRR is also not screwed up, because, you know, if when we calculate IRR, the most important part is the overall payments received and made during the life of the entity. And you know, so if they take the cash at the day one, and if they are investing that cash after 2 years, the IRR may get screwed up. So from the perspective of IRR also, they have to take care and they have to call money as and when required and not at the day one. Whereas in hedge funds, since they buy and sell on daily basis, they don't care. Like if someone is ready to put $100 million, they'll ask to pay $100 million on the day one itself. Okay, amount invested. So we discussed hedge funds normally, you know, more than 90% times are open-ended. Like if some fund has started back in 2017 and if someone wants to enter in 2019, they are open. They will entertain. But in case of private equity, suppose they have started in 2017, the most, if the governing docs allows, they can do a subsequent closing where in addition to the initial investors that they had in 2017, they can take few more investors in 2018, but that should be allowed as per the limited partnership agreement. So that is, subsequent closing is majorly seen, like if the investment manager sees more opportunities in the market and they want to raise more money, they would go ahead with the subsequent closing. But that should be governed by the governing docs, like an operating agreement. Liquidity, the assets or the investments held by hedge funds are liquid in nature comparatively when we say about private equity. Of course, they would be less liquid when compared to other investment product types. But when we compare with private equity, the hedge fund investments are more liquid in nature, whereas private equity, since the investments are in portfolio companies, it's very illiquid, you know, in nature. Management fees. It's on like management fees is based on net asset value, which I said, like in both cases it is, you know, fixed in nature, like you have to pay it. But in case of hedge fund, it will be variable, like, you know, as in like if a management fee for December month on an assets of 100 million would be like, you know, on an annual basis, like $200,000. But on January month, if the NAV goes down by $100,000, so the accordingly the management fees for January month will be calculated on that amount. But in case of private equity funds, in most of the cases, the management fees is charged on commitment amount. So in case of like 2017, in an example, if we see the fund has been there is one capital call made in on the day one of the fund start, and then the next capital call is made after 2 years, depending on the capital requirement. But the management fees for the 2017 and 2018 would be charged on the capital committed amount, because though the manager didn't call capital like on the day one itself, but still he would require some money to run the office. Hence, the capital commitment amount is the basis of calculating management fees on the private equity funds. With respect to performance fees, I think we discussed in detail, like in case of hedge funds, we have annual incentive fees called as performance fee or performance reallocation. But in case of private equity fund, is more about carried interest, which is basically we see what is the return the private equity fund has given since inception and not the early returns. So as we spoke about the return ratio also, the total return ratio is in hedge fund and the IRR is in private equity fund. Total return ratio take cares and, you know, tells about the yearly return, whereas the IRR states return from the inception of the fund. Strategy, you know, the hedge fund strategy is like seeks more rapid exit from investments. But whereas in private equity, considering the nature of investments, require investments to be held on a long-term basis to allow for value creation. Hola?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah, sir.
Yeah. So also, you know, with regards to last point, withdrawals, redemption rights, like I'm sure everyone would be clear by now that in case of hedge funds, you know, comparatively, the redemption, you know, restrictions or the liquidity restrictions would be less compared to private equity funds. And they couldn't give an advance notice of like, say, 2 months, 90 days, or, you know, a month back also, and the withdrawals can be made. But in case of private equity funds, since it's a closed-ended fund, all the investments are fees, investors are fees, there is no as such right available to the investor on an LP where they can invest money or redeem money. Then, any questions so far?
Yeah, there is one question. Do hedge funds in startup like VC?
Do hedge funds in startups
like VC? Like investment, yeah. He's selling, do hedge funds in startup like, he's telling VC investment.
So if I take this question in this way, like if there is a startup, would hedge fund invest into it? They may invest into it if their strategy allows to it, but normally in a startup, a PE fund or a VC fund invests, not a hedge fund. But hedge funds can do that, I've seen. Okay, I think we can move to the next slide.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so over here, I just tried to summarize. There would be like a more classification of private equity, but this is on a higher level. Classification and stages of private equity funds. So the first right inside, you know, the pictorial of the pictorial is the venture capital. So basically venture capital is like, you know, more of like investing, a fund investing into a seed stage, like, you know, at the start of the fund. It's basically that kind of entities name themselves as a venture capital funds. So there are differences between venture capital and private equity, but more or less they are the same. The major difference is like private equity may invest money in the running operating companies, but venture capital do invest in the initial seed capital, like, you know, the start of the any venture. Okay, so venture capital is the seed stage. So there are various phases also where venture capital invest is basically seed stage, startup stage, expansion stage, or replacement of capital. So when it is expansion of stage, there may be a very thin line between private equity and venture capital characteristics, but still venture capital do also invest when they, the ventures that they have already invested or any new ventures where they are looking for expansion and they need money. Okay. Buyout strategy is basically a strategy where, you know, you infuse capital by, you know, taking some loan or leverage. Okay, so you take capital from mix of investors, which is equity and also some debt, and then you invest into a company. That kind of things are called buyout. It can be leverage buyout, it can be management buyout, and there are different types of buyout. There are other kinds of ways also where private equity can finance, like the first one is time finance, which is basically mix of you know, equity and debt, where they are financing a particular venture and giving equity as well as debt. So that is mezzanine finance. That could be distressed financing, like for example any particular company not doing well and is distressed, so in that time they can come into it and finance them and get a very good valuations after a certain years. So these are like, you know, special, you know, event-driven things, like, you know, yeah. Let me know if you guys want me to detail out more about venture capital or, you know, the seed stage, startup stage, because it's altogether a different topic and, you know, like 30, 40, maybe more than our topic. But, and I think we are just like 15 minutes, roughly 15 minutes away from our end time. So Zaki, like, is there anything like on the chat, like,
no.
If I can go ahead? Okay.
Okay, you can go ahead. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. So, so when we say that private equity investments make investments in portfolio companies, so like, what is the product type or what is the investment security type that they use as, like, you know, investing into portfolio companies? So if you see in the pictorial, starts with investors investing with into private equity fund. Private equity fund using the below, like just a list, not an exhaustive but an inclusive list. This type of instruments can be used to invest into a portfolio company, like bridge notes, convertible preferred stock, warrants, distressed debt, partnership interest, and many more. Okay, so I think this requires, like, you know, after this training, maybe if anyone is interested, they can see like what is bridge note, what is convertible preferred stock, due to, you know, scarcity of time, I cannot, you know, cover this, like, you know, products in detail. But yeah, of course, there should be readily available resource material when you do a web search. You should get some data. Yeah, I think we can move to the next slide. Okay, so I just tried to summarize so that, you know, you guys have a, you know, you can gaze out, like, you know, what are the valuation approaches used by private equity or venture capital funds. So basically, you know, just to make sure, you know, like, you know, what are the approaches, at least like understanding how in a particular approach, how things are valued is a secondary, but it is also important, like, what are the approaches, like to name like three of them. I think they are the most common one: the market approach, the income approach, and the asset based approach. And then market approach, in market approach, we still have like two types of, you know, valuation methodology. Again, in income approach, we have two ways valuing a particular investment, and in asset based approach, we have one methodology. So in market approach, you have guideline company. So basically a guideline company is a company where you have similar type of business setup, and you have some kind of similarity between the operations of the portfolio company that you are valuing and what values available for another companies in a database, like which may be listed, so you can get their data from the exchanges. Some would be having some quarterly reporting or something like that. So that is basically taking reference of guideline company, like, for example, what is the PE multiples or the price to book ratio of a guideline company. So similarly, that ratios can be used in the portfolio investee company that I am valuing based on what is the revenue or what is the earnings. I can derive the value of the same. M&A transaction is basically the recent transaction that happened in similar type of setup in any other company in the same geographic location. So that can be also used as a base to value a company. You know, like maybe the same company that we are valuing based on the M&A transaction that recently happened, that can be also the basis of valuing that company, which would be coming under the market approach. Okay, so coming to the income approach, the two main methodology are discounted cash flow and capitalized cash flow approach. So more or less, like, you know, the discounted cash flow, as we know, we can predict or we can estimate the future cash inflows through revenues, the cash, non-cash and cash income. And accordingly, based on certain multiples, we can value the company. Okay, so again, in income approach, the more important is the prospective estimated income to be received or cash inflows to be received. Whereas in market approach, we see the current scenario. What is the, like, if you talk about guideline company, what are the multiples in the guideline company and what are the current amounts for the portfolio company that I'm investing and applying that multiples. But in income approach, you have to estimate the future cash inflows. In the asset based based approach, it's basically the asset accumulation method where you have the net assets. Maybe you can take that, you know, as a book value, net assets, or the valuations, or, you know, or there would be like certain process and set certain steps to be followed in each of the methodology to be seen. But my main intention is like to make you aware, like, what are the different valuation approaches and how they are broken down into various segments. Okay, I think that's it for this slide. We can move to the next slide, I think. So guys, like, just wanted to make you aware, like, you know, what is trending in the private or alternative investments industry or this field. Maybe, like, you know, since last, like, maybe a year ago, but still, like, still there are things which we see this will be, you know, trending and continuously. Other investment funds, like, which we talked about, like 15,000, so maybe 1,000 firms may have already adopted it or have already thought about it, but there is still very much scope of this things that we will be, you know, covering in the next couple of slides. So AI based algorithms. So basically, what is algorithm is like all the hedge fund strategy is not based on like market sentiments or VC news channel, ye buy karna hai ya ye sell karna hai. Is based on certain algorithms. That algorithms are based on, you know, certain inputs of data. Algorithms were always done, like institutional investments, like hedge funds earlier also. But the point is, like, now artificial intelligence is used to run that algorithms and get the data out, you know, So basically, the point over here is like, you know, when you create an algorithm, so it's basically you have to you have to have some database where you have to, you know, process it and then see the outcome. So similarly in AI based algorithms also, the human intervention is very less. It's basically a self-learning, AI based algorithms are able to build trends that are often unknown even to the most intelligent analysts. The reason is because they are able to eliminate the noise in the market. This refers to short-term daily or intraday fears, worries and negative fuel perception regarding the price of a security or general market atmosphere. By ignoring it once, is able to identify trends in the market, and based on that trends, the AI based algorithms are able to adapt as a result of a neural networks built to allow for deep learning, which then allows the algorithm to adapt accordingly. So basically, when we, of course, like, you know, as we say that trading is again, like, you know, there would be a debate upon whether it is a science or an art, but still when we are trying to use more or creating less human interventions, we are moving towards like science based. So similarly, AI-based algorithms work on the past trends that they have been inputted with. As you can see in the diagram, database goes like for the, it can go as like for long, for 15 years, based on the, the system. They process their data, they predict something, they reprocess, predict, and then they give their results out. What they, as per their prediction, what would be the, you know, stock price, or we should buy or we should sell. So this will be like, you know, more now science driven and trend basis, but of course you can't totally neglect the art part of it or the analysis part of it, which humans do. But yes, still, this is the trending thing, and it will grow more in the coming months or coming years, like the AI based algorithms. We can move to the next slide. Let's see what is trending. Robo advisors. Okay, we have been hearing out this like since couple of years. We have dedicated funds which are only restricted to decision making by robots. So robo advisors are a class of financial advisors that provide digital financial advice on investment management based on mathematical rules or algorithms online with moderate to minimal human interventions. So there are certain funds. You can go back and see and do a web search. You can find the yearly returns what the robo advisors, using robo advisors, that fund has earned. And they are typically, you know, with minimal human intervention, they take their own decision based on the inputs given to them. And yeah, so far they have been given a decent returns, not more, or didn't outperform much compared to what we see in non-robo advisors. So robo advisors means like I have an investment manager who is a robot. Yeah. So basically, yeah, that kind of things would be trending more based on the performances that the robo advisors give. Cryptocurrencies, I am sure everyone would have heard it, and maybe few may be trading at their own also. Even the hedge funds are nowhere behind. They have also actively started trading the cryptocurrencies, and they are in a better position compared to an individual to understand the overall mechanism of the, or mechanics of the cryptos. So basically we'll see more and more things, more and more hedge funds entering into cryptocurrencies, though in some countries it is still, you know, a gray area, like not very clear, it's legal, illegal. Recently, Supreme Court of India intervened and uplifted the RBI's banning the institutions who were acting as an exchange for cryptocurrencies. So that was again welcoming decisions for the persons who are dealing into cryptocurrencies, but still, like, there is no yet clarity in the terms of legality and other stuffs. Also, it makes life difficult for an auditor because there is no as such audit trail easily identifiable, like whether they are, or who is holding, who is the custodian, and etc., like the valuation part, because it's very volatile. So, but still, like, you know, there would be ways find out, and there are already exchange ETFs with regards to cryptocurrencies. Like if you want to take exposure of multiple cryptocurrencies at one time, you can buy an ETF and you can reap the benefits, or, you know, you have to bear the losses, whatever the, so basically an ETF is just a consolidation of different securities, in this case cryptocurrencies. The movement in the cryptocurrencies will impact the movement of this ETFs also. So you people have also started, instead of buying the cryptocurrencies directly, they buy ETFs, the exchange traded funds for the cryptocurrencies. So, but yeah, it will grow. I'm sure it will grow by leaps and bounds in the coming months or years. So far, the cryptocurrencies market around 290 billion to 300 billion, and they largely it is traded or driven by the investment funds, as you see in the last line. Okay, so these were the things that we can it's trending, and we can see more things happening around this three things. There would be many, but I just like to share with this group about this three trending things in the alternate investment side. Maybe we can move to the next slide and see, maybe not see, but peek into the future. So probably these were the all-time favorites of the alternate investment funds, and maybe I think the liking would continue to go in the technology side, the blockchain, the consumer side, the healthcare infrastructure. So these are predominantly the sectors which would be attracting more to the, the investment managers or the the traders, being technology replacing everything, the iOS part, like IoT, Internet of Things, to add to it, blockchain, we need to see like how hedge funds operations would be impacted in terms of using blockchain, because as you know, the blockchain is like a distributed journal ledger. So in that case, is like, as there are different service provider of an hedge fund, which is mainly one of the main service providers, the brokers and the custodian. So in case the whole ecosystem is moving towards blockchain, the things that are currently happening, like the audit trails or the auditor support, would change. There would be an impact or a major change in the things that are being done currently. Once blockchains started getting introduced by the hedge funds or the service providers of the hedge funds. On the consumer front, of course, the FMCGs and the consumer durables, non-durables are all-time favorites. And the analyst traders would like to, get more into more, the consumer companies which are involved into consumer servicing. So basically you can see in the coming futures also, the liking or the interest moving towards these three areas like consumer and healthcare and infrastructure. So I think that's it from my side. I'm happy to answer any questions, and also happy to revert back if there are any questions after this session. Please feel free to reach out to me on my email ID. I'll try my best to respond. And also, if anyone need any guidance, any kind of counseling with respect to especially students, how should I go ahead with my CPA degree, or if I want to make career into hedge funds or any other field, I would be happy to get into a call and counsel if anyone requires that, as and when time permits. Yeah, Zaki, over to you, and happy to answer any questions if any. Okay, I think if there are no questions, we can wrap up the session. Thank you so much. You have been like awesome audience, and very appreciate the questions that were asked so far. And thank you, Zaki. Also, thank you, Sanjeevni, for coordinating and getting this done. I hope this session was helpful and will help in at least getting an overview of an alternate investment funds from the audit perspective, and how the industry and the regulatory part also works. Thank you.
Okay, sir.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you. Okay. Bye.